Lord have mercy, look at how the time goes.
And welcome everybody to this episode of the Coming Home Podcast with John Allen. I am, of course, your humble host, John Allen. And today I have a long distance guest by messenger video chat. His name is Matias Bergstrøm Andersen, coming from Denmark. Hello, mister. Hi.
Hey, how are you doing?
I'm doing fantastic. It's a beautiful day over here in Norway, across the water from Denmark.
Yeah, yes, well, summer is beginning.
And I have to say, now I am very fluent in Norwegian. I'm very proud of that. But I have trouble understanding Danish. It's, of course, as people know, it's a Scandinavian language, so it's very similar. But you guys are way on the far end of the spectrum of my understanding.
Really?
Now, is that my fault because I hear wrong, or is that your fault for talking wrong?
I don't know, man. We have a lot of immigrants coming from like Middle East and Asia, and
yeah,
they describe speaking Danish like talking with a warm baked potato in their mouth. And
you know, that's what my wife says. My wife says that Danes sound like they're speaking Norwegian while they're choking on a potato.
Maybe that's true. I mean, they are similar languages, but yeah. I mean, us Danes, we have no idea what Norwegians say either.
Really?
All I remember, I was on a ski trip back in school. Like, all I remember them saying from being there, that was the, hey, dude.
So you guys have as much problems understanding Norwegians as Norwegians have problems understanding you guys. I see.
Yeah, I mean, I don't understand people very well, but that's the only combination of words. That was the hey du that I remember them saying. And that sounds like a really fucked up way of saying hi, and like, that's all I remember.
Now, how about Swedish? How does do you understand Swedish very well?
I know Jartebra, and that's almost it. They are very, very close connected, Denmark, Sweden, and Norwegian, and Germany, and
yeah,
maybe even Finland a little bit, but I have no idea what any of them are saying.
No,
like, yeah, no idea.
Yeah. Well, so be it.
Yeah.
Now, you are an up-and-coming, or how do we say this? You are a new beginner in the online training industry. Am I right?
I guess you could say that.
Yeah. Now, do you have a focus on powerlifting clients, or are your clients from a broad spectrum of training styles?
I would say a combination, because actually I was taught how to powerlift by a Danish legendary powerlifter.
Yeah.
Who is actually the only person in Denmark to deadlift over 300 kilo without a belt. Not to say he was the only one who could have done it, but he was the only one who has actually chosen to do it in a competition.
Okay.
And like, I learned a lot from him. And but
what's his name?
Carsten Larsen, Carsten Holm Larsen.
Okay.
They call him Dozer and Viking, and Dozer Viking.
The Dozer Viking, yeah. Okay. Find the Dozer Viking online, people. Check him out.
There isn't a lot of him, but if you search him, then you might find his Danish championship competition in 1996. And you might even find a few training videos where I'm in and we are fooling around and flipping plates and finger wrestling type stuff.
And you say that the Danish powerlifting championships in 1996?
Yeah.
Okay, that's going back a ways.
Exactly. So you can just type in dozer with a C, like a bulldozer.
Mm-hmm.
And
Dozer, yeah.
Yeah, and the Danish championship 1996, it will come.
Okay, check that out on YouTube, folks.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's where you got. So you got coaching, you got instruction from somebody who really knew what they were doing. Then the best in the game at that time in Denmark.
Yeah, one of them.
There's not a lot of people who can say that. I truly believe that proper instruction from the beginning is. It's worth its weight in gold. I was lucky enough to get into lifting weights as a very young person. It was in my preteens, and it was in combination with American football, and all of my coaches they knew what they were doing when it came to lifting weights. So I've had that that proper instruction from the very beginning. And it sounds like you had something similar with the Danish dozer.
Kinda. I mean, I went to the gym actually because I'd had lower back pain for like a year and a half, and I wasn't it turned out to be sciatica.
How old were you then?
Almost 20 years old.
Isn't that
like,
a bit?
I just kept training and banging my head against the wall. Like, it's like the harder I can train, like the better it is in my mind. Like, even to this day, I still kind of think that way.
No, isn't that kind of young to have back problems in your, you know, in your early 20s like that?
Well, I mean, I was a kid the first time I had some type of discomfort or even pain in my back, to be honest.
Okay.
Because I played a lot of video games. So.
Ah, there we go. There's always a reason.
Yeah, spent a lot of time.
Okay. Yeah. So you talk about just kind of training through the injury. Now, you're not a typical meathead, are you? I mean, you're going to think and you're going to train proper, correct? You're not going to bulldoze your way through your training, right? You're going to think a little, you're going to apply the proper principles, correct?
I like to think so, but those who know me might not always agree. Like, sometimes they disagree. That I do have that kind of meathead mentality, that kind of like the more heavy work the better, but I've been moving away from that at like reading the books and listening to people and searching advice from different people. And I mean, I like to think a lot.
Yeah, and that's a good thing, because I think having a thinking man's perspective to training, that will provide you with the longevity that you need. You're still pretty young. How old are you now?
26 years old.
26. So you're a little more than half my age. I'm 50 and still getting stronger. And I believe the key to me continuing to get stronger is my cerebral, my thought process, my cerebral attitude towards training. I try to be a monster in the gym, but I try to be a thinking monster.
Yeah, I mean, exactly. Like, you want to do crazy shit, but you can't do it all the time.
Exactly. Yeah. So what kind of a training philosophy do you have when it comes to programming? How does that match up with trying to be an absolute beast in the gym? Because programming equals planning and thought, correct?
Yeah, I mean, that's a very, very open question. Before we get too deep into that, I want to backtrace a little bit.
Okay, yeah.
Where you said before that I talk about training through injuries, I just want to make sure that everyone is caught up to what that means in this context. The way I talk about it is, you don't want to do it. Like, sometimes you can in certain ways.
Yeah.
If you have bad pain, do not do it. Like, John and I know it. So like, I just want to make sure everyone else does as well.
That's a good point. You know, like I say, I try to be a monster in the gym, but I want to be a thinking monster. And a good example is exactly what I'm going through now. I've had a series of rather serious shoulder operations, especially the last shoulder operation, which of course has made it impossible for me to directly train shoulders and impossible for me to bench press. So I have to train around that. In other words, I have a physical therapy program to take care of my shoulder. But other than that, I'm still making gains in my deadlift and in my squat. So,
You told me that you had some muscles removed from your shoulder. I mean, I didn't even think that was something that they do anymore.
I have had so many tears in my supraspinatus and infraspinatus. I don't know what that is in English. They can think, whatever. Supraspinatus and infraspinatus. Figure that out in English. I've had so many tears and operations on that they have, especially my infraspinatus. Just to explain, the infraspinatus is the muscle that goes from your shoulder blade and around to the front, to the side, kind of the front of your shoulder. That tendon is completely gone. It's completely atrophied. So that what they have done is taken Achilles tendon, not my Achilles tendon, but an Achilles tendon from a donor, and sewn that in my lower trapezius and connected it to the front side of my shoulder. So that is supposed to give me more stability, support, and give me that outward rotation movement back. It hasn't happened yet. I'm still going through intensive physical therapy, but in the long term, it's supposed to give me that outward rotation. But my days of big benching are over. So this is a new, I'm the only patient in Norway to have had that particular operation done. I'm kind of like an experiment. So, but with that
does not sound good.
Well, but you know, I was just going to say, I think it's very good. I think it's exciting. I am one who is constantly trying to better myself in all ways, but in this context, physically, I'm trying to better myself physically. I'm trying to get stronger. And the fact that my shoulder is messed up, of course, you can first look at that as a terrible thing. But the cool part of it comes in when I know that I am the only patient in Norway who has had that operation. I have tight contact with my surgeon and with the physical therapist, and they are watching me. They are guiding me and watching to see how I do in my recovery process. That is a lot of responsibility, but I love it. I love it. It is a challenge. It's a huge challenge for me, but I love it.
It's like a kind of adventure of sorts.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. I want to be the guy who has that challenge of getting my mobility and strength back in my shoulder. Basically, my shoulder does not function at all the way it is right now. So the challenge is to get it to function, and that is a huge challenge. And that challenge for me means growth, mental, emotional, and physical growth.
Yeah, I'm sure it is mostly mental.
Absolutely. Yeah. Because in the scope of things, if you look at, you know, that small little tendon, that small little Achilles tendon that they've put in is such a small part of my body. But the challenge is probably the biggest challenge that I'm currently going through for the last year. That operation was in May of 2019. And that has been the number one focus in my daily life, is to train this shoulder up to functionality. Huge challenge, huge mental challenge.
Okay, so as a powerlifter, would you say that your main focus is to improve your squat and deadlift, or is your main focus to improve your shoulder functionality?
You know, I would say that my main focus is twofold. In other words, it's both of those things equally. I want my shoulder... Well, how do I put this? For my day-to-day life, forget about powerlifting, for my day-to-day life, my number one goal is to get my shoulder back, because I'm in constant pain. The pain is incredible. I can't even describe it. And I have a fear of strong painkillers, opiates. I don't want to touch them. So I'm not medicated for my pain. I'm just getting through it. So in my day-to-day life, that's my biggest challenge. Now, if we go over to powerlifting, as I said earlier, I know I'm never going to have a big bench again. But one of the benefits of getting older is that I am now in the Masters 2 class, you know, the old guys, 50 and above. And I would like to think that I have a big enough squat and deadlift to compensate for having, like, maybe in the future, 100-kilo bench, so that I can be competitive on the world stage. That's my powerlifting goal, is to make myself competitive on the world stage and get back to competition.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense, since we are seeing a lot of people as they get old, like, there's usually like at least one joint they have problems with. So,
yes.
I mean, all you really need is to get far enough with your squat and deadlift that whoever you have to beat, they have a shitty bench also.
Exactly. And if you think about it, a bench is not going to win. In general, a bench is not going to win a powerlifting competition. That's the smallest number in your three lift total. So I'm not stressed out when it comes to that. I just need to get back to a point to where I can, you know, right now I couldn't even bench the bar, which is only 20 kilos, as you and I know. I probably couldn't even do that right now. So my goal is to just get to a point where I can do that, so I can get back on the powerlifting platform. I miss it. I miss competition.
Yeah, I'm sure you do, as a person who wins. I mean, I've not won a single competition, and I was bored as hell being there, to be honest.
But you know what? You know my thought. Tell me what you think of this. I think that, of course, it's cool to win championships. It's cool to set records and all that stuff. But I am in a constant battle with myself. I want to lift more than I did at the last competition. That is my first and number one goal. in powerlifting is to always lift more than I did the competition before. You know, the competitors, they can do what they want. And of course, I enjoy a competition, but number one goal is to lift better than I did previously. What do you think of that? Or,
well, I'm probably going to piss off a lot of people right now.
Do it. Let's have some controversy.
Because I don't give a shit about self-betterment on competition day. Not for me. Like, I can get better in the gym. Like, if I squat 200 kilo, like, I haven't actually done that because of excuses and a bad knee and a meathead mentality. but let's say one day I do it. Well, if I haven't done it before, I'm better. I don't need to go to a competition to do it. If I squat 205 kilo, well, that's a 5 kilo improvement, regardless of where I am. I mean,
I see.
You know, so I mean, the definition of competing is to do better than everyone else. At least try to. So the way I see it, if I have no chance at all of winning gold, like of course you don't always know who's going to show up.
That's true.
With what knowledge I have, I know like there's no fucking chance. Like several other guys would have to get injured for me to even get bronze.
Okay.
Like, why would I show up? Like, I can be there in the audience. I can have fun if I know people there. Like, I can watch and I can, like, after someone has competed, I can go and ask them questions if I want to. But I don't have to compete to do any of that. I don't have to compete to be there and have fun.
Well, in a way, you and I kind of have a matching way of thinking. Because as I said, my first goal is to always lift better than I previously did. And that is done in the gym. That work is done in the gym. But there's also a big part of me that has that desire to compete against other lifters. And you just don't feel that at all.
You know, that's another thing I'm going to piss off people by saying. The idea that in the gym at training, you should never compare yourself to anyone else, and you should never compete with anyone but yourself. That's absolute fucking horseshit for almost every single person in the gym, or even on earth.
Okay, how so? What do you mean?
If you have big goals, then you want to surround yourself by people whose mere presence would want you, or would make you want to be better.
Absolutely.
Like, you can push yourself so far, yeah, that's right, but what if you have a cup of coffee? Like, what that does to you is it makes you a little bit more up. It makes you a little bit more focused if you are focused already. Like, it's the same with everything else. Put on a song that motivates you. Yeah, you actually become even more motivated, even if you were already motivated as fuck to begin with.
Yeah.
Like, why wouldn't you use that from the people around you as well?
That's a very good point. I, in general, especially these days with the quarantine and all that stuff, I train alone. I don't have a training partner, so to speak, but I do have a crew of friends who train at the same time as I do, and I always have better training sessions when they're there.
Yeah.
You know, I none of them are stronger than me, so I don't have that stronger lifter at the gym to try and catch up to. I don't have that, but I do have that vibe of motivation that I pick up on from my friends who are at the training center at any given time. Absolutely.
Yeah, I don't care if someone can only lift like 50 kilos, so long as they push themselves.
Well, I can tell you, the amount of weight that my motivators lift means nothing to me. I can give you a great example. My number one motivator is a tiny little Norwegian woman by the name of Hege Nielsen. If you see
that's Ed Cohen's girlfriend.
That's Ed Cohen's lady, yeah. she is my absolute best friend. I've known her for 25 years. Mm-hmm. And she, when we first met, now back then I was a bodybuilder. This was like in 1996, 97, something like that. I was a bodybuilder at that time. And she always used to tell me, John, you should try powerlifting. And I just wasn't interested at all. So it wasn't until I came here to Norway. In fact, I'd been here in Norway for a long time. It was in 2015 that I'd had my first powerlifting competition in Norway. And Hege has always been the motivator behind my training. So if I tag tiny little coach, a hashtag tiny little coach on my training videos, that's her.
Okay. Yeah.
And she's a tiny little midget of a woman. She's, you know, everyone has this idea that Norwegian women are these tall, blonde, no, but she's not. She's very short, and she's dark-haired. So shout out to Hagen Nielsen. No, but so and you know, she's just a tiny little woman. But there's something about her being there when I train that motivates the heck out of me. She's Ed's woman. They're living there in Chicago, but Hagen spends about half of her time, roughly, here in Norway. So when she's here, we train together. And that's
okay. What's she doing in Norway? Like, how do you?
Well, her mother still lives here, so she has a lot of contact with her mother and stays with her mother when she's here in Norway. Yeah.
Okay. Family. So Ed, he stays in America, and she comes to Norway.
He's
the time apart.
Yeah, in general. Now he has he was here in Norway last summer. He did a seminar at a strongman competition here in Norway, and then he was here in Norway quite some years before that. But in general, Hege comes, Ed does his thing, and Hege is here with her mother. Family, you know, okay. Family.
Yeah. Family is important, so.
So they sure. say. Now, some people's family is getting on their doggone nerves these days, but in general, family is important.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's fucking...
I'm not speaking for myself.
Awful and hilarious to see all the people complaining about having to spend so much time with the family because of the corona situation. It's like, yeah, I mean, you choose a lot of your family, so...
Yes. Yeah.
So how about that?
No, I can in all seriousness, I've been having a great time. I feel this last month I've gotten closer to my wife. I mean, we spend a lot of time together already, so that my wife and I get to spend even more time together. You know, that's just a good thing. I'm also enjoying being more involved with my children's schoolwork. You know, they're sitting at home online, doing their lessons online with their teachers, which puts me more in the swing of things when it comes to their schoolwork. So I'm enjoying myself. And, you know, like you say, you choose your family. So don't get mad at your family if you're going crazy. Now get mad at yourself for making the wrong choice.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. If it's a family, like a significant other or something like that, you chose it.
You chose it, yeah. Yeah,
yeah. You can also, you can have friends you are not related to, but they're so good friends, you consider them family. Like
yeah.
You can just go live with them, I mean.
Yeah, absolutely.
You have responsibilities and opportunities and choices you can make for yourself. Quit whining on social media.
Yeah.
If I ever have a girlfriend and she whines on social media, forced to spend more time with my family, I'm just going to kick you out, go out and die of corona or something. I mean,
so if it gets,
respect me or fuck off.
are you, you have a girlfriend, right? Or are you married?
No, I mean, it's hard for me to find a girlfriend because I'm so blunt.
Because you're so, you're too much for the ladies. say it that way. Don't say you're too blunt. Say you're too much for the ladies. They can't handle this.
Yeah, I'll go clubbing and say that, see what happens.
Give it a try. Now, what are
my name is Matias. How are you doing? I'm single because I'm too much for the ladies.
There you go.
What
try
you
that.
Doing tonight?
Try that. Yeah, but don't they like a bad boy? Don't the ladies like a bad boy? So if you come off kind of arrogant and straightforward like that, then they might like it. They might like it.
Let's just say when I go out and, I mean, it's not that uncommon for me to be called a Viking and sometimes even Hercules and stuff like that because I'm so tall and I'm not so skinny, you know. And
how tall are you?
Yeah, there's plenty of 188 centimeters, 6'2".
Okay,
so,
yeah. Oh, I'm just a little guy.
It's pretty easy to get attention, but it's not always the attention one might want to have.
That's true. Well, I'm just a little guy. I'm being here in Scandinavia, I notice my shortness. I am 174 centimeters, 5'8", and that's pretty short for Scandinavia.
You're pretty heavy, though, aren't you?
Yeah, I'm right now I'm somewhere between 130 and 135. I haven't weighed myself, but I'm on my way down. I had ballooned up to 148 kilos with all these operations going on. That's just too heavy. I just wasn't meant to be that heavy. A more natural solid weight for me is around 116 kilos. Well, that's what I weighed when I came to Norway. So I'm on my way down from 148. I'm probably around 130, 132 right now.
Yeah, I remember being 116. It's pretty fun. Like right now, I've gained weight up to 110 kilo. A lot of it is bloat because during the corona thing,
yeah,
I just felt like I needed to fucking unwind from everything. So I took like a month to do like fewer hard sessions, training sessions, and I just kind of ate whatever I wanted to because I just needed to unwind.
Like, I see.
My joints, my mind, everything feels a lot better now, so I really needed it.
Yeah.
But I was up to like 123 kilos actually because I was in chronic pain for over a year.
Okay. Wow. Yeah, from that back injury, right?
Well, I did feel that my thoracic spine separated from my lumbar spine, but actually the pain came from a digestion problem.
Oh, okay.
It turns out not a single fucking person anywhere near where I live knows about IBS, irritable bowel syndrome.
And that can
like, irritable bowel and say I have pain here and no one knows, so it took me a long time to find out.
So irritable bowel syndrome can affect your spine?
Well, it can pull on your muscles because your intestines, like the muscles around the intestine, becomes tight, and it can actually pull on your psoas.
Uh-huh. Oh yeah, the psoas, of course. Yeah.
Yeah.
Shout out to David Goggins, who talks about the importance of the psoas muscle. That muscle right there, I tell you.
David Goggins is insane.
He's an animal. Oh, that guy. There's people who pay him to move in and live with them. I wish I had that kind of money. I'd just let that guy move in with me.
Yeah,
for a
me too.
but yeah.
I would move in. If someone wanted to pay me to move in with them, I would say yes. Just fucking do it.
Free food, you know, like, free food.
That too, but like, what a fucking job to have.
Absolutely. Yeah, that psoas muscle is extremely important. I don't have a back injury per se, but there was a time a couple years ago where I started to be very sore in my lower back. And then I actually think it was from videos from David Goggins that I got the idea to actually loosen up that psoas muscle. I did that, and within 2 days, my back pain was gone. But when you think about the mechanics of the body, and where the psoas is, what it's connected to, of course it's going to lead to lower back problems if it's tight.
Yeah, and, exactly. It's the lower abdominal muscles and the psoas major, the iliacus, the adductors. I mean, everything.
Yeah, people think
you can fucking do involves the muscles around your hip, your front hip.
Yeah, and it's not necessarily a back problem. It is a imbalance in your muscular system that leads to the back problems. For those of you who are listening and don't really know what we're talking about, go in and Google psoas muscle. That's P-S as in Sam, O-A-S as in Sam, P-S-O-A-S, psoas. Look it up, people.
Psoas major, yeah.
Psoas major, yeah. Check it out, people, and see what that muscle does for you or against you, depending on how healthy it is. And by healthy,
you might feel something and then feel like something is tight or loose or something in your lower abdominals. It might actually be your psoas major, or it might be both of them being connected and not really coordinating properly.
Yeah.
But actually, like, if anyone has lower back pain, like, there's a very high chance it has absolutely nothing to do with a weakness in the lower back or tight muscles in the lower back. Like, it is generally from like the psoas or the calf muscle, the butt cheek muscles, the glutes, you know, and your fucking neck, it comes from there. I mean,
Well, I can tell you with these shoulder problems that I have, it's amazing what that has done to my whole body. I mean, I'm talking from my head down to my feet. If you think about it, think about the mechanics of the shoulder. If you when you walk, what do your arms do? Your arms swing. Well, with these shoulder problems, my left arm isn't swinging the way it used to, so it's changed the way I walk. And then because I always have to support that left arm when I sit, it's causing me to sit different, which is then causing things to be misaligned. And so it's a challenge. It's a challenge.
Just the walking with uneven swing in itself. I mean, like, a lot of people don't know it, but even the compression force on your spine, like, you wouldn't think about compression, but it becomes uneven.
Well, And since this last surgery I had in May, I've bought a, have you seen those yoga swings? You hang them up in the ceiling and then you can, They use it for, they call it air yoga. These
like a sex swing.
Yeah, well, you know what? My dirty mind. That is what I thought. I'm like, man, that looks like a sex swing, but it's actually a yoga swing, and you can hang
in
it.
Of course it is.
Of course it is. And I'm so, now the real me is revealed now. Okay, people, I bought a sex swing, and it is called a yoga swing, and you can hang in it. You can invert, hang upside down, and I have put that into play in order to decompress my spine, decompress my hips. You can even decompress your knees by hanging upside down in this thing. And really? Oh yeah, absolutely. But it's all in how you wrap the straps around your hips or your legs or your back. It's a great piece of equipment. Just check out, for those of you who are listening, check out Yoga Swing. Do it on YouTube, and then you can see exactly how it's used. Or you can go to Pornhub and check out Porn Swing.
That was what I was thinking, and then you said it.
you dirty man, you.
Yeah, hey, but don't tell my mama.
What's her number? I wanted to ask you, what are some of the challenges you face as an online trainer? Because online training is something that's quite different from face-to-face, person-to-person training. I'm not saying it's better or worse, but what are some of the challenges you see?
Well, one challenge is that a lot of people seem to think that face-to-face training is better, even though it doesn't have to be. Yeah. And when I ask them why, they don't really know. that's always the part where I have to convince people. And
a lot of people are kind of locked into what the conventional consensus is, and they're going to automatically think, well, it's better if it's face to face.
Yeah, that's true. And I'm the opposite of that, so it's a challenge for me. Online coaching wise, not a lot of people talk about how hard it is to build the business and how much of a salesperson you have to be, but yeah. I mean, that is a part of it, and sure. It's hard.
Personality,
really, online coaching can be a lot better, because let's say you have an hour with a personal trainer or a physical therapist or chiropractor or whatever. I mean, you pay for an hour,
yeah,
maybe $80, something like that, and you go a week or 2 weeks without talking to them, and then you see them again and pay them again.
Right.
With me, you pay me, and you get to talk to me every single day about your problems, and about how I can help you solve them.
Now, how do you talk to them, by video chat or by telephone call or texting?
Usually just texting. I mean, there is the option to call, video call. You know, it's a per need type of thing. Voice messages.
I see.
But it's generally just texting, because that's what people tend to prefer.
So I can easily see how the online thing, with the daily follow up, is much more beneficial than, as you say, seeing a personal trainer once a week. Big difference in when it comes to follow up.
Exactly, because there is a weekly follow up, maybe every other week, but mostly a weekly follow up, and every single day between, if something happens, just text me.
Yeah,
it's that simple. Yeah. I'm not going to be pissed off, or so long as you don't send me 30 messages a day after we've already ended a conversation, it will be all good.
Well, and what I like about the concept of online training is that it puts a lot of responsibility on the client, because when I owned my gyms, I would have personal training hours with clients, and the worst thing for that relationship is to have a training session with a client who hasn't done anything at all since the previous session. They haven't asked any questions. They haven't done any training themselves. And it's almost like you're starting fresh every time you see them. So
it's like you have an hour to train, but you have to spend half an hour of that time to fucking talk to them.
Yes,
it's so annoying.
Absolutely.
It should be even more annoying for the person, but for some reason people don't really see it.
Exactly.
So maybe they listen to your podcast and now the problem is solved.
Well, my goal is to have millions of listeners. So all of a sudden you're going to get millions of phone calls with potential clients.
Dang.
Well, the thing is with online training, your client base is limitless. You know, you can be anywhere in the world and have a client. So do you evaluate video from your clients? Do you have a regimen around that every week they have to send you that week's videos?
Yeah, actually I do. And if they want to do it like after every single session, they can also do that, to be honest. And like, yeah, there's no way I'm going to train someone who is not going to show me how they lived. Like,
exactly.
I'm not going to be able to. Like, that's why the online fitness game business is so oversaturated by online coaches. And that's why a lot of online coaches, like, are easily judged as being phonies and fakes and no good.
Yeah.
It's because so many of them just give out some standardized cookie-cutter program to people they don't know anything about. Like, I have to know about. I have to know who you are.
Yeah.
What are your goals? Do you know why you have them?
And the ongoing evaluation by looking at their videos, of course, is optimal. You have to know how they're doing.
Exactly. And I have to see them even do stuff at home, like simple exercise, like a side bridge, or like, hey, if you stand on one leg, what happens? Like, I have to see all kinds of things.
Right.
Of course, but when I say all kinds of things, like for one person, it might be like a few things. But there are a lot of different things I might need to check for depending on what that person needs.
Right.
So like, I need them to be okay with videotaping whatever I ask them to video for me and send it to me so I can see what happens. So that if they have a problem, I can tell where does it come from.
Yep.
And there are so many different things, like so many tools in my toolbox that I can pull out and I can use.
There you go.
So, I mean, you might have a program with like four exercises. You go very hard, like 5 days a week or so. Four or five exercises, and I might just want to see like two videos, like the second and the last set of like two of the more complex exercises, and then the last set of like bicep curls and like smaller exercises like that.
Right. Yeah.
But I need you to want to do that and be open to the possibility that maybe I'm going to ask to see you do more things other than that.
Exactly.
Because I need to know what the person is doing and how.
And that evaluation, and you see how they're doing, that's going to determine your recommended adjustments to the program. If they don't give you that feedback by asking their questions, by sending you their video, it's going to be impossible for you to give them any sort of a progression on their program.
Yeah.
And they can't blame you.
That's what I hate about the internet. Like, the internet is a fucking disservice for most people.
Yeah.
I mean, it takes so long to build up a bullshit radar where you can just, like, read something and know, okay, that's bullshit, moving on.
Well, I know of high-profile fitness people, whether they're bodybuilders, powerlifters, or Instagram models. I'm not going to mention any names, but there's a lot of high-profile people out there who do the cookie-cutter program. You know, if you email me and pay me $350, and I'll send you a program. And, you know, that is exactly what they do. They get $350, and they send a program, and then that's it. The client never hears anything from them. The client never gets any kind of follow-up. And I don't understand. Yeah. When there's guys like you and guys like myself who are legitimate, who legitimately want to help people, who legitimately want to coach people, you know, this high-profile Instagram model will just give a program, but you're here to coach someone and help them make themselves better. Big difference in a big... Yeah. The price may be the same, but you're going to give that client much more in the way of results.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Because some of these high profile people, they are expensive because a lot of people follow them.
Yeah.
And believe in that bullshit.
Yeah.
So they just drive the price up.
It's a shame.
You know, and they send you something that they have sent to like 100 other people.
Yeah.
And you think it's made just for you. Like, it doesn't work like that. And you may have gone through the internet. You may have looked at some Strong Lift 5x5, which is a terrible program I used once and I really regret it. Starting strength, whatever, that tells you, just do barely anything, just move in these few movement patterns and these very few, and just add weight every time. Like, that's the best you can do. Like, just do it for like half a year or 1.5 years straight, and that's good. Like, no, it's not. You have different lengths in your arms, different leg lengths.
Right, exactly.
Your upper and lower arm lengths, one versus the other, is different. Your upper and lower leg lengths are different. So the exercises you have to do may have to be different.
I was just going to say, I know a lot of people who will insist that you're supposed to squat this way or you're supposed to deadlift that way. I can give you an example. So, a lot of people will coach that you absolutely never should allow your knees to track track in front of your toes when you squat. But you can't say that because, as you say, everyone is built different. Your lower leg ratio to your upper leg, your ratio from your upper torso to your lower torso, you know, all of those things come into the picture. So a good coach will ask for video of a potential client to see how they squat, bench, or deadlift before, and take that as a starting point and then build on that, because everyone's body mechanics are different. Do you agree? Just say yes.
Exactly. I might even need to see mock shots. full from the one side, a full from the other side, a full picture, full body picture from the back, and maybe even sometimes, not like just sometimes, maybe even in your underwear.
Sure.
Well, no one is going to be forced to that, but it might be necessary just to see what does your muscles, where do they pull you?
Yeah. Well, you know, it's about the body shots, you know, maybe in their underwear. I'm not a nutritionist, but I have coached people and guided them on their nutrition in order to change their body composition. Now, if you're a client, let's say you're a female client and you are just too shy or whatever, you don't want to weigh yourself, for example. And I'm not saying the scale is the tell-all when it comes to your what kind of shape you're in and your level of fitness, but it can be used to measure progress. But if you're a woman who's so embarrassed you never want to tell anybody how much you weigh, well, then you are just removing that one tool.
Yeah.
And if you're afraid, if you're too shy to send a picture to your coach to show them your body composition, you know, you're asking for help to change your body composition, but you don't want to send a photo to your coach. That's, you're just making things harder for that good cooperation, that good flow of information from coach to client and client to coach. So people kind of have to let go of those inhibitions, you know, and be a little bit more open about those things.
Or at the very least, just remember, the more your coach knows about you, the better. So if you are not, if you don't want to send those pictures, fine. But if that kind of shyness also keeps you from informing important things, then maybe go see a psychologist instead.
You know,
I'm not being condescending here. I mean it sincerely. Like,
that is true.
Maybe go see someone who can help you with your mind.
You like, posted a video the other day talking about stress. Now there is
today, actually.
Was that today? Okay, yeah.
Right, before you called me.
I'm messed up. I never know what time it is these days. Yeah, that was today.
I know that too.
So I am one who believes that there is a direct connection between your physical state, your mental state, and your spiritual state. In other words, body, mind, and spirit. Those things are connected. So can you say, I don't know, talk about the video that you posted. What were you saying about stress in that video?
Can you first, what is your definition of spirit? Like, what do you think when you say spirit?
Well, I'm a religious man.
Okay.
But I don't believe that you have to be religious to have spiritual content in your life. For example, if you are a man or a woman who is very much tuned into the concept of honor and respect for people around you, and you have incorporated that as a big part of your life, then you have put yourself in a spiritual mode, and that you are, How do I explain? Do you understand what I'm saying? Are you going to make me explain it even more?
Almost.
Spirituality does not mean religion. There are people who feel, for example, they're very connected to the earth. There's people who tell me they can't be in a good mental state unless they get the spirituality of taking a walk in the forest or in the mountains. They feel a connection with the world when they do that. That is a spiritual concept. It's not a religious concept, but it's a spiritual concept. I believe.
So it's like an element of a personality type.
A big element. I'll make it more specific in that it is a big element of a personality type because, again, you don't have to be religious to be spiritual. For example, if you, you get the picture.
Yeah, you're beginning to regret that you said spirit before.
I'm finding it difficult to explain what I mean because this is kind of more of an inner conversation that I've had with myself, not something that I've vocalized to too many people.
You related to your inner child and your self, your own idea of your own self realization.
There you go. Dr. Matias.
And, thank you very much. So like the reason I ask is because it tends to be a vague definition. And like me in my mind, I'm a bit more black and white. Like when people say spirituality, the first thing that comes to my mind is, well, you just said psychology and spirituality, but they're the same. You know, they're kind of not. There is some type of understanding that they're not. Yeah. But like I'm answering from the perspective that they are pretty much the same. Like,
And
that's how my mind works. That's why I had to ask.
I believe in God. So that defines a certain spirituality. There's a lot of people who don't believe in God. And I can say if that non-belief in God, if that atheism guides that person through their life, well, then I would define their non-belief in God as a spiritual path.
Okay.
Do you see what I'm saying?
Kind of.
No, yeah. I'm weird. I'm weird.
Well, I'm weird. Like, I'm that kind of, a part of me is like being rational and logical and stuff. Like, obviously, I'm a human being, so I'm not always like that, but I tend to be more than other people, so I'm not the one you tend to have spiritual conversations with.
Yeah.
Well, because it's just outside of my scope of understanding, you know?
Let me ask this, and this has nothing to do with the scope of understanding. What do you think will happen to you when you die?
Well,
what is
my body is going to rot or get burned. Like,
yeah.
I don't know anything other than that.
That's your body, but what about your consciousness? What about your mind? What happens to your mind when you die?
But I don't know. I have no idea. Like, maybe the light is just going to be shut forever. Maybe, like, some type of energy flows and goes elsewhere. Maybe I become a squirrel or something. I don't know.
And that not knowing, okay, and that's fine that you don't know, but that could be, and you are a thinking man, so imagine what it would do for you and your awareness and your control of your own actions and control of your own vision and your desires and your ambition if you walked down a mental path and tried to figure that out, or at least formulate some more thought about what happens to you when you die. And I'm not saying that's going to lead you to a Baptist church and you're going to start praising God and all that. I'm not saying that. I'm saying that it might open your mind to a whole nother way of thinking about your purpose here and what you're capable of and how you influence others. It might.
Yeah, I mean, what happens is I remove thought from myself. Uh-huh. Put it on other things and other people, and that kind of frees my mind up to like take life more serious for one reason or another. Uh-huh. So I can kind of see that, if I'm playing a team sport, like, and I'm thinking more about my mates than I am myself, then I'll push myself harder.
And that,
so I can see that, but I can't relate to anything. other than that.
But what you just said, but what you just said is the way you think about life, correct?
Yes.
And the way one thinks of life is one's spiritual concept of life. So you are spiritual. You're not religious. At least you haven't shown that or said that, but you have a way of thinking about life. And spirituality is just a formulated and conscious way of thinking about life. Now, that's not the dictionary interpretation, but that's kind of the way I rationalize the whole concept of spirituality. Doesn't mean going to a church. Doesn't mean praising God or reading the Bible or the Quran or whatever. It means having a path or having something that guides you, a way of thinking that guides you through life.
So like the more one thinks like a philosopher, the more spiritual one is.
I do believe that. Okay,
that's fine.
Yeah, someone like Neil deGrasse Tyson. Do you know who he is?
Yeah,
someone like him. Yeah, exactly. Someone like him who can sit and just, you know, throw out all of this knowledge and all of this information. And he will tell you in all of that, that he's not religious, but he will say that he is spiritual and that he has a view on life and what it means and how he wants to live it. So in his own way, he is spiritual. And yet that has nothing to do with religion.
Yeah, in my mind, like for my personal view and for how I think, I would probably still say that spirituality and psychology goes together because it's all a matter of how someone is thinking. But it doesn't have to be like a black and white setting. Like other people can think of it in other ways. Like that's fine by me.
Because the problem, because the problem is when people claim that their own spiritual path is the only proper way to do it. That's when problems arise.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, one people can be a straight-up law-abiding citizen and have honor, and like another person can like be a fucking thief or a terrorist or something, and feel like they have honor.
Exactly.
I mean, it's very subjective, everything.
Absolutely. Wow, what a conversation. First, we're talking about powerlifting and all that goes along with that, or training, rather, and all that goes along with that, and now we're talking about spirituality.
Yeah. I'm like, conversations with me are like that. We get all around everything.
I try not to be a one-dimensional person. That's boring.
I feel the same way.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, I've forgotten what you asked me.
You know, it all started with, I think we need to take our ADHD medication. What it started with was...
Fuck that.
Yeah, thank you. I'd rather go train. You know, for me, here's another side thing. For me, training...
new conversation.
Well, we'll get back to my original question, which was about stress in the video that you put up. But I just want to throw this in there. You know, I'm joking about we need to take our ADHD medication. And yes, some people go that route and some people may need that. I don't know. I'm not a doctor. But for me... training, in other words, physical activity is medicine for a lot of physical ailments and mental ailments. For me, training is therapy in many ways.
Yeah, I think it's like environmental and psychological. Like people with ADHD, like they pay attention to everything around them.
Yes.
Like if you live in a third world country, I think that having ADHD just means you're a fucking survivor.
Like,
that's no other label. Like you notice things around you, like threats and stuff like that. And there's also a thinking part. Like especially if there are no threats or no problems you are really solving. Like you might think a lot more thoughts than you need to about things you don't need to think about. What that is you have a lack of certainty. Because if you know exactly what you need to do and why and what is the solution to the problem, like you don't think nearly as much.
Exactly. Yeah.
So what you have to do is if you live in a boring place, no problems, you play too much Candy Crush because that game is like solving problems, you know, and you get like a dopamine release and like you have to put yourself out there and find problems to solve.
Absolutely.
Set some goals, man. Set some long-term goals.
Activate that mind, and you may not, and I'm not saying you won't, but you may not need that medication. Activate your mind and body, and,
exactly.
you may not need that medication. That was my little...
And then that actually goes back to the spirituality thing, because if you realize that you have ADHD or something like that, some sort of problem, but every time you take a walk in the forest, you feel grounded.
There you go. Yeah.
Well, that tells you what you need. So you exactly. need to be in nature more.
Exactly.
And again, I'm not saying you have a child in you. You have some experiences
yes.
from when you have to find out as much as you can. Why does nature feel good for you? What can you do to get that feeling out when you are not in nature?
You know, yeah, take the time to analyze that whole situation and what it does for you, and you might find that it will solve a lot of problems.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Physical and
mental
challenges.
Don't just use it to cope.
Yeah. Exactly.
Don't use it to cope with your problems. Use it to transcend your problems.
That is a whole different aspect of coaching that we're talking about right now. You know, and that's another thing that I try to make people not make them, but I try to inform people about that. For me, at least, training is not just the physical side. It's not just sweating. It's not just getting bigger and stronger and getting in better shape. But it's the mental thing. How can training bleed into my life? So that I can expand myself mentally as well as physically.
Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, the mighty Adam said it himself, strengthen your mind and the rest will follow.
There you go.
Do you really think he only meant that your tendons would get stronger and you could lift more weight?
Exactly. There's much more to it than that. No, there's much more to it than that.
Yeah. But
let me get back to my original question about 10 minutes ago. you posted, and it's my fault. It's my fault that we got off on this tangent. But
no, I do too.
But going back to the question, is the video that you posted today about stress? Can you talk about that? What were you talking about in that video about stress?
Well, I remember saying, because I don't remember even everything right now because we've talked so much, that I think I started the video saying that when you have been through stressful situations a long time, like without really catching a break, like I was bullied growing up, for example, like I was stressed the fuck out every day. What happens is your baseline of stress actually comes up a little bit higher. Because
In other words, your body gets more used to being stressed. It's almost like getting addicted to a drug.
Exactly.
Yeah,
exactly.
Yeah.
So when you are at a quote-unquote relaxed state of mind, like if another person felt that state of mind, they would actually feel stressed out.
Exactly.
Because being stressed becomes your new norm.
I see. Yeah.
And that's why relaxation is so important. I mean, it's no wonder that people take walks in the forest, they listen to relaxing music, they go to a masseuse like at least once a month to relax, you know. But
so
the problem is just that a lot of those people, when they do that, like, they're still fucking stressed out. Like,
so
if you go for a walk for 2 minutes, for 2 hours every day, and because you are stressed, and you continue to be fucking stressed, it's not fucking working. Something else is needed.
So
something on top of it. Not instead of, but on top of it.
So they need to go...
How about you go... I'm going to finish this one. Like, how about you go for a walk for an hour instead, maybe just a half hour, and you do something else to get relaxed. Not something relaxing necessarily. Maybe something hard. Maybe you look yourself in the mirror and ask, why the fuck am I so fucked up, if that's what you think of yourself? Why am I so fat? Not chubby, no. Why are you fat? Why are my muscles why are my muscles so weak? Why am I skinny? No, not just, why do I have problems? Why do I do this? Well, because of stress. Okay, moving on. No.
Address the problem directly.
What do you mean by stress?
Yes.
Like when someone tells me, I'm sorry I disrespected you, I was stressed. It's like, yeah, I might say, yeah, okay, we all make mistakes. But really what I'm thinking is, no, you're not fucking stressed. You're having a fucking problem and you need to figure out what it is so it doesn't happen again. Like, you need to put in work. Yeah, maybe stress is the last thing you need. But if you put in the right type of work, the work that you really need, the work that even if you are an overthinker, you just think of that one thing and you begin to calm. And your thoughts begin to disappear.
Yeah.
That's the thing you need to do, because when you do it, you will practice how to deal with what is going on inside your mind. You will practice on how to deal with the heavy, high stress, not how to ignore it, no, how to actually get it lower because you feel better about yourself. You go to a happy place, all that type of stuff.
I see. So in other words, what people find out is it that people spend so much time on the surface of the problem. Oh, I'm stressed. And yet they don't have the, for whatever reason, they don't take the time to use their mental muscles and dig underneath that surface and find out why they're stressed and deal with that specific problem.
Exactly. And of course, if just asking, what can I do, is something that makes you really fucking tired to the point where you can't even do the fucking dishes, of course, go get a massage, go for a walk, go take some time to feel better. But maybe instead of asking how can I do it, maybe try asking yourself, like, what do I want to do?
Uh-huh.
Maybe, because when you find something you want to do, you get a new flow of energy and all your problems feel more easy to battle. Even if you're still stressed out, it just feels easier to do something about it.
So
that's what I'm getting at.
That falls in line with something that I've heard Stan Efferding say. Now, he was just thinking of things from the physical aspect. He always says, when it comes to recovery, physical recovery after training, the things that people do for you, like massage or manual therapy or whatever, the things that people do for you do not work as well as the things you do for yourself, in like taking a walk. Yeah. So if we apply that to the mental side of things, like what we're talking about when it comes to stress, people should get under the surface of that thing and find an activity, something they actually do physically in practical terms to better their situation. Am I right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly. Find out what you need to do. Like, it's probably going to be something you're good at. So once you do that, you begin to go after that goal, here's what you have to do for the rest of your life.
Yeah, because it doesn't stop.
Find out what you hate to do and what you suck at doing.
Yeah.
If doing push-ups makes you fucking, in your mind, just hearing me say push-ups, how about instead of going down and doing like 5 sets of 10 or 5 sets of 20, how about you do 20 sets of 5? And then when you can do it in less than half an hour, how about you add 10 sets?
Here comes Coach Matias.
10 sets of 3 or something like that.
That's fantastic.
Try to make it drag out. Practice to spend time doing it. Don't just get over with quickly and once or twice per week. Like, go hard at it a couple of times per week.
Yeah.
But do a little bit every day as well.
Use some time on it, roll around in it, and feel what it's doing for you. And that's something that one does over time.
Yeah. Get dirty in the pigsty.
Get dirty in it.
Yeah. Get your fucking hands dirty.
So what do you do? What do you do when you're stressed? What do you do to relax, besides buy a sex swing or a yoga swing?
Pornhub. I go for walks every day, and then, like, speaking of staying everything, I walk every day,
okay,
3 to 4 times.
Yeah,
like, I try after every meal, but sometimes like I don't, or sometimes I have 3 meals instead of 4, but for the most part, 4 meals, 4 walks of at least 10 minutes each. That relaxes me, that helps me digest my food, that I feel more relaxed also. And that's pretty much it. Like, I listen to music if I want to sometimes, but I haven't done this in like 2 months. Sometimes in the evening when the sun goes down and it's dark in my room, I lie down, I put a timer on my phone, like, to ring in 60 minutes, and I put on relaxing music and I just lie down there.
Okay.
And what I do when I lie down there is I make sure not to fall asleep. Some people end up doing it, and that's okay. You just try not to. And even more important is, if you have a thought, say, oh, that's a thought, remove it.
Uh-huh.
Try to be absolutely free from thinking.
Just empty your mind.
Empty your mind.
Meditation.
Most people, when they do it, and do not jump out of the bed when you're done. Like, most people are going to get out slowly from their bed because, at least they should, because most people, what's going to happen is their legs become jelly.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's like it feels like you're standing or walking on jello, so like your leg starts shaking, or you grab onto something or sit back down because you're afraid you're going to fall on your ass. Like, that's how relaxed your nervous system becomes.
Wow. And how long should people do that every day?
Probably no more than an hour, because it becomes really long-winded. I mean, it could be 15 minutes even.
Yeah. I make sure I don't lay down, but I make sure that sometimes I could lay down and do it, but I make sure I at least sit down, sit still with no TV, no music in my ears, and those 15 minutes are just for me to sit down and find peace. And within that means removing all thought, trying to get away from anything that's stressful, anything about thinking about what I have to do or what I should do or what I should have done earlier. I try to just remove all of that and just be 15 minutes of being in the moment and finding peace. I try to do that every single day. I cannot remember, as a matter of fact, the last time I didn't do that. That is a daily routine.
Everyone can do it once.
Yes. Yes.
I mean, I actually find that if I have like two meals in a day where I have am on the computer or have the TV on while I eat, I find that I'm actually beginning to be a bit too stressed and I need to like back off.
Okay, yeah.
I have seriously begun to like make a rule of doing nothing while I eat. No talking, no texting, no nothing.
You just sit
relax while I eat. Yeah. Let my stomach receive the food, let my stomach work, and then right after, maybe sometimes it takes a little bit, like half an hour, but preferably right after I eat, just go out, walk around the block, or walk through the forest, or walk over to some iron bars near my local grocery store, and just do some training, like just relaxing food,
and
go for a walk.
And how long is that walk? And how long is that walk usually?
Usually like 30, 60 minutes, but okay. 10 minutes is just fine. I mean, it's, like I said, I've dialed down my training a lot, so I have more energy to just walk outside, like one foot in front of the other.
Man, that's fantastic. That's good self-therapy. And I believe that having that routine alone, take the time to empty your mind of thoughts, that you take the time for that walk after you eat. Doing something so simple as that can drastically change a person's life. It's a lifestyle.
I want to talk to anybody while I eat.
Yeah.
It becomes an annoyance sometimes.
That's fantastic. Yeah.
Yeah.
I believe I'm a believer in the value of silence. Now, you know, I'm here with my wife and we have our two kids. One is 14, one is 12. So there's a lot of talk at the dinner table. And no offense to them, but sometimes I wish everybody could just be quiet. I'm going to tell them that Coach Matias said, be quiet, shut your mouth and eat.
go through that. I mean, I don't I never really gained anything as a kid from sitting at the table, all of my family, and talking.
There's some benefits.
Like, I gained nothing.
Yeah. I guess that's an individual thing. There's some benefits to that. You know, when we gather to eat, it is kind of like a moment for us to acknowledge that we are family and that we care about each other. You know, we can, and I don't even like to ask the kids how their school day went, because that can lead to some stress. I don't like to do that. But that we sit and just talk about whatever. They love to hear me tell stories about when I was young, some of the silly things I did, or I'll actually use a lot of that time just to tease my wife and make her laugh, make the kids laugh. That's our moment, kind of to connect socially as a family, but again, I see the value in taking that time to just be silent and not even focus, just let yourself take in that nourishment and let it do what it's supposed to do for your body without any outside stimulus.
Exactly. Yeah. Like just eating together, but not talking so much. That's my thing. Like when I was a kid, I was bullied a lot, so I didn't really talk to my family. So
you were bullied.
Of course, it's an individual thing. And
were you bullied? I'm sorry. Were you bullied within your family, or were you bullied at school?
at school.
Okay. Well, but you didn't think that that was, and I'm not criticizing, I'm just asking, you didn't think that because you were bullied at school that at the dinner table that might have been a time to talk about that with your parents?
You know, maybe, but no.
It just didn't, it just didn't work out that way.
You know, kids don't really know what's good for them oftentimes,
true.
You know.
That's and, true. That's true.
Like, I don't really, even today, I don't have, deep conversations with my parents. Like, my brother sometimes tries a little bit, like, we have grown to do that a bit, but very, very little, you know. Like, it's just not in my family to, like, be understanding and have deep conversations.
Okay.
Or even good conversations. Like, we are very antisocial in the way we conversate together.
I see.
Not antisocial, but just not very social.
Not very.
So it just never really happened.
No. Well, you know, everyone has a different family dynamic. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. And that's allowed.
Yeah, it is.
So you, wow. I think that's very interesting that you are in touch with that mental side of things. You're not a one-dimensional coach where all you want to do is make your client sweat. You know, there's also that side, that mental aspect of it. I firmly believe that the mental and physical are very, very tightly connected. Absolutely.
Me too. I mean, if someone has cancer and they had a very serious traumatic life,
yeah.
I mean, maybe if they had a better life, they wouldn't have cancer. Mm-hmm. Like, one can't say for sure, but it's a strong possibility.
I believe there's something to that. Absolutely.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah.
Like I'm not exactly, I never really dived deep into that that type of literature, you know, but like, it is my understanding, at least on a surface level, that we are getting more and more data for the people who are way smarter than me to interpret and deal with
that
our endocrine systems, our mentality, our physical body, like, it's all connected, even with disease. And like, in the next decade or two, maybe 30 years, like, we are going to, like, have our mind blown a lot of times about that, I think.
I have been reading, and don't ask me to tell you where these sources are, but I have read several different sources where they are doing a lot of scientific experiments, and people are really working on the connection between the digestive system and the brain. And that the digestive system should be put up on the same level when it comes to organs as the brain, because your thought process is very much connected to how you digest your food, which again is determined by what food you put in yourself. And they've done things where people who have been heavily medicated for being schizophrenic, by changing their diet, if that has changed their digestive system, and that has enabled them to come off of medication for schizophrenia.
Well,
that's
fascinating.
That is fascinating. That says something.
Schizophrenia
right
and Alzheimer's, yes.
Alzheimer's as well. So that's
they have one thing in common, those two, and I know because I looked a little bit at it, because my grandfather not too long ago got Alzheimer's actually.
Yeah.
And the thing is, Alzheimer and schizophrenia are correlated with a deficiency in dopamine release.
Yes.
In other words, you are a dopamine dominant type of person. That means when you yell really loud, when you do weird things, and like when you're just like a type of eccentric person, like that gives you joy. That makes you calm inside. Even if you look very wild on the outside, you feel calm inside because of that dopamine release.
Yeah.
When you play Candy Crush and you solve it, et cetera, and like the people who are like that, they have a higher risk of getting Alzheimer's or schizophrenia. And the thing is, this is a neurochemical brain hormone. Brain hormones are common food.
Yeah.
Like, a lot of people, like some people with this type of behavior might actually feel a little bit calm if they have a little bit less carbohydrate-rich foods and a little bit higher, more protein-rich foods.
Yeah.
Because in proteins, amino acids, some of them, have the dopamine in it, or they are converted to it or something like that.
I wonder if that has, I'm sure that has something to do with how they say that if you eat a diet that is too low in fat, you will be more susceptible to Alzheimer's. Someone told,
I think,
where did I read this? I read something about if you are on these cholesterol medicines to lower your cholesterol, that can open you up to be more susceptible to Alzheimer's. I want to say I've read that several places. I don't know how true it is, but I've read it.
I think dive into the different types of fatty acids, it can become very complex.
Yeah. And,
I don't know really, but I think actually it's true from what I remember, like from various random sources. But like I'm not comfortable speaking on it, to be honest. I don't know how it is.
Yeah, I don't want people to think I'm trying to be a doctor. You know, I'm just throwing out some information that I've read. But I'm almost 100% positive that I have read several places where anti-cholesterol medicines lower certain fatty acids that then open you up to a higher occurrence of Alzheimer's because you're missing some fatty acids and whatnot. I'm not sure. I'm not a doctor.
Like, cholesterol itself is very complex, because like a long time ago, everybody thought that cholesterol was all bad. Then they came with the idea that HDL cholesterol is good and LDL cholesterol is bad.
Yeah.
And now is the idea that LDL cholesterol is more complex and usually not that bad after all.
Yeah.
But they are not really sure how it works, and they're not really sure why. So like, like that's just a complex topic itself. And
It is.
I mean, the combination of like saturated, unsaturated, monounsaturated fatty acids is like... just the thickness of the substance itself. I mean, there are many theories that we have yet to uncover.
Yeah. It's interesting.
The way that they're sending like signals for insulin through the substance, like saturated fat is a thick substance.
Yeah. So we're back. Technical difficulties. John had to go talk to Snoopy and use the toilet, you know, nature calls. But here we are. We're back now.
Yeah. So as I was saying, like, I think it's pretty hard to know for sure what exactly is going on with the fatty acids, because like there are different types and there are different substances and we don't even know exactly what's going on with the whole cholesterol thing. So
yeah, it's fairly
who the hell knows?
Yeah, fairly unexplored territory. Yeah, I don't know. Yeah. I'll keep eating my fat and hopefully I won't get Alzheimer's.
Me too.
You had a question for me about
yes. So you have told me that you had some records in powerlifting.
Yeah, I have some records in powerlifting. I have some push pull records, some, you know, bench and deadlift combined. Push-pull records back home in the state of Ohio in the United States. I lift in the USAPL, IPF, the American branch of the IPF, USAPL, and there I have some state records in push-pull, deadlift, and squat. I cannot remember what my total is for the push-pull. I can't remember what my deadlift is, but my squat is 3.42.5 kilos raw for a state record in squat. And then here in Norway, I have the national Norwegian record. I'm not a Norwegian citizen, but I qualify for Norwegian records because of my residency here. And the Norwegian record I have is 335.5 kilos raw. And I did that last year as a 49-year-old. So I'm extra proud of that record. And I, like I told you earlier, I'm still doing what I have to do to train hard and get stronger. So that record will be raised.
Yeah, those are some big numbers. I think here in Denmark, the deadlift record with a belt and sleeves, well, I don't know if they use sleeves for deadlift, but people use all kind of shit. But
yeah,
that has just gone up to 332.5 kilos, regardless of age.
Okay, yeah.
So you could actually beat that.
I would like to try. No, but again, it goes back to that thing. I'm just trying to get better. I'm trying to be a better lifter than I am. But of course, it's very cool. I would say one of my greatest athletic achievements is that squat record that I got last year as a 49-year-old. I just don't believe in that thing that just because you reach a certain age, you cannot get in better physical shape. You may have to change the way you train. You may have to change your thought process, but it is very possible to continue making gains as a so-called older powerlifter. Absolutely.
Yeah. I mean, what many people don't realize is that for old people, they may not be able to walk up the stairs on their own. But they don't have to stand on one leg while they're powerlifting. They're just going to like stand on both legs as they can, and then bend their legs and get back up. I mean,
exactly.
Powerlifting is for life. You don't get too old to train for powerlifting.
Absolutely. You know, I look at guys like Anthony Harris. He is in the under 120 kilo class. He lifts in the USAPL. He squatted well over 300 and... Yeah, I don't remember. But for a while, though, he had the world record for the under 120 kilo class in the squat raw. And he was 51, 52 years old at that time. So, David Ricks is another power lifter who was older. He's 56, 57. He was a world champion at that age, or maybe last year, a couple years ago, or whatever. So to be an older lifter and still be making progress is quite possible.
Yeah, especially in powerlifting. I mean, some people actually peak in their 50s.
Yeah.
So I mean, why not?
Why not?
It's not like you turn 35 and then you have no testosterone anymore. No, it goes away very slowly.
Yeah, you know, I hear people say, oh my gosh, I turned 35, now it's all downhill. Well, maybe for them it is, but I'm not a believer in that. And
how many people have really, really reached their genetic potential before they are 35 years old?
Very few.
Yeah, so why the fuck couldn't some random person with skinny arms get stronger and more muscular in their 40s?
I'll take any 40-year-old man who has never trained, or woman, any 40-year-old man or woman who has never trained with weights a day in their life, I will take them, and within 2 years, I will make them believe, I'll make it to the point where they're going to want to change their name because they're such a different person than they were 2 years ago. I mean, it's possible.
Exactly.
Not only is it possible, it's likely to happen as long as you do the work.
I believe that. I mean, I had people who in just 1 month, it was like a transformation for them.
Yeah, absolutely.
I mean, young people who didn't have a lot of muscle and hadn't really learned how to lift correctly. Like one girl actually, I helped her in 3 weeks and she credited me for saving her life, which
it
may be a bit exaggerated, but she felt like she was finally ready to stop having suicide thoughts.
Well, I don't think that, I don't think that she spoke out of turn. I mean, you probably literally did contribute to saving her life.
Yeah, I mean, all I know is that learning how to lift correctly and how to diet when you're not happy with yourself, I mean, that can really turn someone's life around quickly.
I believe
very
that.
Very quickly.
Yeah, I've seen it happen. I had a lot of people. Like I told you earlier, I used to own some gyms. At one point, I owned 3 gyms here in Norway, and I would travel from gym to gym doing personal training with clients. And I saw several occasions where, most often, it was women. You know, young women in their early 20s who. They may have had thoughts of suicide, or they may have had a serious problem with self-confidence and self-image. And like you say, very quickly, in a matter of weeks or just a few months, it just turns their life around. Like I said before, training is medicine, not just physical medicine, but mental medicine.
It really is. I mean, it removes them. It helps them remove themselves from the I'm so this and I'm so that and everything is so fucked up, and it begins to make them think like, hey,
look what I can do.
What if I continue doing this?
What if I did? Look what I did so far. What if I do more? What happens then?
Exactly.
And you start chasing your better self.
And that's what a lot of people just the one thing a lot of people have to do is just quit saying I can't do it and start saying how can I do it.
There you go.
Open questions.
Yeah.
Give you answers. They open up your minds to opportunities and make you think in a wholly different way. And that's a lot better than just having yourself put negative thoughts back in your mind and try to forget them, because it removes them.
Well, people complicate the process with their negative thoughts. They complicate it because it really is not more difficult than deciding what you want, giving yourself a time frame in which to achieve it, and then doing the work to make it happen. It's really not more difficult than that, but we can make it more difficult with negative thoughts. And
I mean, I'll one up you there and say that many people should set a goal that they might never achieve. They don't know if they can actually achieve it.
Dream wild.
Yeah. You have to have a certain way of thinking already before you're able to do that and get motivated from it. And you have to be able to believe in yourself enough that you only ever raise your expectation, ever only raise your goals, not lower them. But I mean, if you're able to do it, aim as high as fucking possible.
There you go. I like to have an image of me having an invisible backpack. And as I go through life, I fill up that backpack with positive experiences, small goals or big goals, whatever, things that I achieve. And for each thing that I achieve, I can put that in that backpack. And the heavier that backpack gets, the stronger I have to be to continue the journey and continue to fill up that backpack. So I'm still in the process of filling it up.
I would think most people would relate that to negative things weighing down on you, not positive things.
How so? How's that?
A backpack, that sounds like baggage, you know? You're carrying baggage.
Well, okay. But I, with the mindset that I have, I am one who enjoys a challenge. I love a challenge because some people will think challenge equals problem. But I look at it as challenge equals opportunity to grow. So you grow, exactly, and I grow through resistance. So the heavier that backpack gets, the stronger I will make myself to carry it. And as I carry it and as I am going through life, I'm experiencing more things, I'm achieving more things, and each achievement goes into the backpack, which forces me to what? To be stronger, to continue the journey. So it's just a circle of growth. It's a circle of growth.
Yeah, I think everyone who's listening can take a lot from that.
Yeah, how about that? And I got it for free. I don't have an ebook yet.
If you run a track and you jump a hurdle, like you are defying gravity for a second.
Yeah, that's true.
You leave the ground, you hover over the hurdle, and then you come back down.
Think about that.
You know, you can jump again.
Yeah.
And that's the thing. Like, that was a challenge. It required that you produced force. You did something.
Yeah.
Like you expended energy to jump the hurdle, but you can do it again. And again and again, and soon you will be able to jump higher, you will be able to jump two hurdles in one jump, all kinds of stuff. Like, if you have a challenge, don't do the woe is me shit. Like, woe is so hard. Oh, but I told you this, so don't say anything to me. Embrace it. Say, hey, that's a big fucking challenge. I might end up fucking dying trying to fight through. You know what? I'll fucking take it.
I like that mental image of jumping a hurdle and defying gravity. Think about what a badass you are. You are defying the force of gravity. There's something cool about that.
Yeah, it's something very small, but if you think correctly,
it adds up.
Yeah, it adds up. Like, the more times you defy gravity, the sooner you're going to, like, fly. but don't jump out of a window trying that. Don't be naive. but maybe someone that listens to the podcast and does it on drugs or something. I don't know.
Hey, so I have to put a legal disclaimer on there. I am not challenging people to defy gravity by jumping out of airplanes or jumping off a cliff.
Yeah, and I'm not telling people to do stupid shit while I'm on drugs because they listen to me talk. Like, every fucking adult with like two sides of one brain listening to this, like, We are not doing that.
There you
now
go.
You know.
There you go. Yeah. See, now we're covered. Nobody can sue us.
Yeah. So,
are you? Have you ever traveled to the United States?
No, but I might. Oh. I might. Maybe one day.
Do you? What kind of connections do you have with American powerlifters or American personal trainers online? Do you get any inspiration from any of them?
Yeah, like no matter where someone is from, if they speak Danish or English, I can take something from them.
Yeah.
I mean, I found you, even though you are an American, so.
That's true. We found each other on social. How about that?
Yeah.
No, I think
so,
we've been
not in the same country. And
I think we've been friends on Facebook for a couple of years now, haven't we? How did that happen? Who found? Did you find me, or did I find you? I don't remember. I know we have
I
a
think
lot.
It was about maybe about a year ago when I started adding a bunch of people.
Yeah, I know we have a lot of friends in common on Facebook. A lot of powerlifters.
Oh yeah, like I've grown to like over 3,000 friends on my Facebook page just from. Yeah. Sending a bunch of requests.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
I think Facebook.
More the merrier.
Yeah, absolutely. And I would think that with your line of work as an online trainer, Facebook is a great advertising tool.
Yeah, it really is. If one knows how to do that stuff.
Yeah, you know. Well, yeah. So. I'm thinking about the video that you posted today, and the two videos, the last two videos that you have. Those are a couple of great displays of your thought process as a person, and of course as a coach. I know if people were to see those videos, it's going to pique up their curiosity about what kind of a coach you are.
Yeah, that's why I'm posting them, actually, to do some marketing for myself, you know. Yeah. I don't know how to do all that stuff, so I just try. I just try and see what happens.
Boy, I tell you, some people are really good at that stuff. I see some people, especially on Instagram, who have, you know, 10, 20,000 followers, and it's like, the content isn't even that exciting, but somehow they've got tens of thousands of followers. I just don't know how they do that.
I think it's a matter of like their personality. Like they're very much come see here, very happy-go-lucky. It's called, and like very exciting to watch. Like, did you know there are people who feel so bad about themselves that they have to go on YouTube and watch people show how they a day of living, a day of eating, a day of training.
Yeah.
Just to see people do stuff with their families and enjoy training with their friends and stuff like that. Just so the people watching can feel like, ooh, I want that. Ooh, how nice it would be to have that.
How healthy or unhealthy do you think that is?
Oh, very unhealthy. Very, very unhealthy. I mean, if you have such a bad life, in your own opinion, that you feel compelled to go every day and watch what some other person is doing in their life, like specifically just what they are doing during a day, a normal day. Like, I don't know what to tell you. I mean, your life fucking sucks and you have to do something about it. I mean, you can also just hear me tell you that your life fucking sucks and feel bad and eat a tub of ice cream. And that pretty much settles it, that it's your own fault that you have a shitty life. I mean, you need to change your mind. You need to change your mindset and go out and do what I've been telling you earlier in this podcast.
I agree with you that if someone is at the point where they are getting their stimulus or whatever, or their, you know, their reason to make it through their day by watching other people get it through their day, that's a sad situation to be in. But if you look at the other side of it, the people who are posting that content, could it be said that those people posting content are doing a service in a way for people who need it? Isn't that a good thing? Isn't there something positive in that?
I think there's something positive with saying, hey, some people are getting something out of what I'm doing. I want to show it. I want to document it. Uh-huh. While that person has other more important shit going on. that they feel themselves is more important. That's fine. But I think if you spend all your time vlogging and you don't have that much other stuff, or maybe you do have that other stuff, but you feel inside that the vlogging is where you really gain something because of the attention, I would not I would not respect that person very much, and I might not even trust them at all, because that speaks fraud to me. That speaks of narcissism. That's like
so an Instagram model who does nothing but film their life. You know, the breakfast they eat. You know, they go to the hair salon and get their hair done, and they film that, and they're basically just filming episodes of their life. There's a certain level of respect that they deserve, as opposed to someone who is a world-class female powerlifter who is documenting her training, documenting how she eats and her nutrition, and then sharing that in the hopes of lifting others higher. In other words, the Instagram model is trying to lift herself higher, whereas the powerlifter, through their documentation, they're putting it out there so that others can lift themselves. Is that one way of looking at it?
With the whole Instagram thing, it's like a highlight reel, and it's a facade, you know? Yeah. Like, someone can post a sexy picture or something, and they can give some good advice. Today I was taking this, and I'm so happy that somehow I can help people. But really, they're just pretending that they're not going for the attention for the picture.
I see, yeah. I think I agree with you.
You have to know the person very, very well. I mean, you could know a person for a year and not even know that they are a narcissist. That if you say yes to make a deal with them to become business partners, they're just going to run with the money, and you're not even going to see it coming.
There are
it's
some
like 1%, 1% of the world population or something like that is a narcissist or a psychopath,
and a lot of them are Instagram.
A lot of them, because that's where they get the ego supply. They have very fragile egos. They feel very bad about themselves, but they are not going to show it, and they are sure as hell not going to admit it.
There's a lot of horror stories about Instagram models who, you know, what they do is they may have 20,000 followers, and let's say I'm trying to sell t-shirts for my podcast. So I would let's say I approach an Instagram model and say, hey, if you wear my t-shirt and give me a shout out, because that will stimulate traffic to my website and more people will buy my t-shirt, and I'll pay you $500. And they say, yes, they'll do that. Now, some of them do that. They take the $500, they wear your t-shirt or advertise your product, and it helps you to sell. But there's horror stories of Instagram models who just take the money and run. And then they'll block you. They'll block you on social media so you can't even complain and let people know what they did. It's an ugly world. It's an ugly world in Instagram thing. Oh, yeah. Maybe it's my age, but I just don't get it.
Do you want a small but very, very useful advice to differentiate between whether they are a psychopath or a narcissist?
Let's hear it.
If someone does something dumb or something bad to you that hurts your feelings, and it seems like they don't care, what you can do is either they really do not care, there's no sense of shame, no anything.
Yeah.
They're a psychopath. Yep. Like, you will kill their mother and they wouldn't even be mad at you, like something like that.
Yeah.
And like, if they are a narcissist, they will feel a sense of shame. You will see they feel a sense of shame.
Yeah.
But the thing is, they don't really care that they hurt your feelings. Yeah. They just kind of know it was wrong. You have to be very, very careful about that, about just assuming that they are not going to do it again and that they feel bad for you.
I'm just going to keep my distance from both narcissists and psychopaths. They are out there, though. Absolutely.
You really should. But the thing is, like, a psychopath, stay the fuck away. A narcissist, like, there's a good chance if you are in a workplace that your boss is a narcissist or something like that, or someone you're responsible. You may have you may not be able to, like, get away from them, because a lot of people, the best bosses in the world, a lot of them are narcissists.
Yes.
Because the narcissist is going to do whatever they fucking takes.
Yeah, they're savages. They do whatever it takes to succeed at the expense of others.
They don't care about your feelings. They just want you to do what helps them, you know? So.
I think I had a Marine Corps drill instructor or two who was a narcissist.
Very likely. So, like, give them some type of a compliment now and then and just stay on the good side. but avoid them. Avoid them if you can.
It's a it's a certain amount of selfishness out there in the world, and I think a lot of people can be selfish in different situations, but it takes a certain, it takes a special level of that selfishness, that focus on the self and disregard for everybody else out there to be a narcissist. But they are out there, absolutely.
Yeah, and also someone might act like a narcissist, come across as one, and not be one. Like, a narcissist can have many traits, like not really care, not a lot of empathy, but if they have a sense of honor, that there's no fucking doubt they will steal even $1 from someone, like, they are probably not a narcissist.
I see, yeah.
They have to be willing to do very extreme things to actually be one.
I see, because most narcissists aren't going to have that sense of honor, you know.
Yeah, exactly. So, I mean, one can seem like a narcissist, but not be one. Yeah. So that's very important also, now that we're talking about it, because I've been accused of being it, because I don't have a lot of empathy. I mean, I just don't understand people very well, but I'm not a narcissist. I don't hate myself, and I don't feel insecure.
That takes That takes a lot of introspection. I don't think I've ever heard someone say that I don't have a lot of empathy. So that takes a lot of introspection, you know, a lot of self-understanding for you to say that you don't have a lot of empathy.
I think people who don't have it are probably very aware of it, because, like, unless they just don't talk to anyone and just don't do anything, because people are going to say it. You don't have a lot of empathy because they are butthurt that you hurt their feelings and they want you to be responsible for how they feel. So you're going to be told if you don't have it, like... You're probably going to hear it.
So you've heard this. So in other words, you've heard this. It's not really something you've realized through introspection. It's something you've realized because people have told you this and then you've thought about it?
Yeah, I mean, also while I have done introspection and just shared it, and then people have said, it sounds like you don't have a lot of empathy. Fuck you.
So where does that come from? What has led you to be a person who has very little or no empathy?
Maybe that I got bullied. I mean, I remember growing up that people would tell me, like, they had been beaten up every day, and they had bad parents, and they had been sexually abused and stuff like that. And I would just look at them. I would just look at them and say nothing, feel nothing.
Because so that I've been
through so many things so many times that when someone had told me they had been through something as well, I just felt like, okay, so they had stress too. You know, that was not what I was thinking, but it was like kind of like what I was feeling, because to me it just seemed like something that is just a part of life, so I didn't get sad for them.
Okay, but if okay, so that's someone sharing some problem, some challenge that they've had, and you don't feel empathy for it. You just think, okay, they've had a problem too. But what if that person said, hey, when I was a kid, I was bullied all the time. Now we're going from empathy to possible sympathy. Can you feel sympathy for that person who tells you that they are a victim of bullying?
I don't actually think I felt that, because now we're talking when I was very much younger, like a kid or beginning teenager.
Yeah.
Like, as I've gotten in my 20s and I've learned more about people and I've understood people better, I begin to have a bit more empathy and sympathy for them.
Okay,
a little bit.
Okay, so you...
So what I just said is not right now.
I see. So you are growing into a more you're growing into a person
empathic,
who has more
empathic.
Thank you. You know your English. You are growing into a person who is more empathic and sympathetic.
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm more patient also. But that was like how far it was for me that when I was a kid, like 10 years old, like in the swimming pool, I saw a man with no arm up to his elbow.
Uh-huh.
And I was like, the only thing I really thought was, that must be annoying to live with without a forearm.
I see, yeah.
That was like the one thought.
That,
like,
was it.
That must be annoying. How does he do that?
Well, I do know that bullying in those critical years... How do I say this I don't know. Some people may get offended or triggered, but I'm going to say it anyway. I think that a certain amount of bullying in social situations with kids is a natural and possibly healthy thing, because it conditions children for the realities of life. Now, of course, bullying can cross over into something that is extremely harmful, extremely psychologically scarring for a child. What do you think about that?
I bully people too sometimes.
I'm sorry, say again? So say again?
I have bullied people too sometimes when I was a kid. So
You've bullied as well, yeah, okay. Yeah,
yeah, and...
So would you agree with me?
That's, by the way, yeah, it is a natural thing. And here's the thing, it's not because people feel bad about themselves that they have to bully other people. No, they actually feel better than the people they're bullying.
I believe that is very interesting that you say that. I believe that as well.
It's a myth that people bully because they feel bad. Yes. If they really feel bad about themselves, they don't want to attract their attention.
I think that there are some kids who are so arrogant, so full of themselves that yes, they think they are better than the other kids, and that's why they bully, not because they don't like themselves.
And you know what? They might be, but it's just a terrible way of showing it. But I mean, I understand what you mean. Like, we all have to go through a path of maximum resistance in life, and like you can try to avoid it, but what's going to happen is you're going to be stressed just opening a letter in the mail, and yeah. Who the fuck wants that?
I mean
like the strongest shall survive and all that. I mean, Louis Simmons himself, like the powerlifting coach, like he says it himself, like he got bullied by everyone who could bully him, and he bullied everyone he could bully.
Yeah, you know, and that is
He's like 74 years old or something like that, and he carries it like a badge of honor.
It's definitely a real aspect of life. There is bullying. There are people who are going to try and exercise their will over other people. Absolutely. I mean, it happens. And it's real.
Exactly. And I mean, I never really had the woe is me mentality. I never bitched to like, oh, I'm getting bullied, so I don't know how to have a good life or stuff like that. I mean, of course, I was sad and all that, but I mean, I never really had that. Oh, you can't say anything about bullying someone. Like, obviously, I can think to myself that people are stupid and stuff like that, but I mean, I've always just, like, it was what it was, and but nobody really taught me how to be a person who doesn't get bullied.
Nobody ever taught you that? Not your parents?
Well, my dad and my older brother told me that next time the guy calls me a bad name, just go and punch him in the stomach. And then one day I did something like that, hit him or pushed him or something like that, or kicked him. And then the teacher got angry and called my parents, and my dad got angry. And I told my dad, but you told me to do it. And he just repeated himself, the teacher told you not to.
I see.
So it's like that's a kind of way I was raised, that there wasn't really a lot of logic to behind what was going on.
That's
at least not for my dad.
I was just gonna say. Go ahead.
No admitting that you're wrong. None of that.
I see. That's a bit of a. I'm sorry. I don't want to say anything bad about your dad, but that's kind of a dick move to tell you to defend yourself like that, but then yell at you when you do defend yourself.
Yeah, I mean, he didn't really yell at me, but like. He is grumpy, and from his point of view, he thinks that he speaks normally. That's just...
I see.
It is rough, but I mean, what the fuck can I do about it?
Well, you know, there's a lot of people who would say, you know, I messed up, you know, this, that, and the other is messed up in my adult life because of what happened when I was a child. And I understand we are the product of our entire life, and that includes our childhood, but... Would you agree that there comes a certain point in our adult life where we have to exert our willpower over the circumstances in which we were raised and start learning new ways to tackle life?
Yeah, I mean, when someone tells me that, I try to be patient and remember that maybe it's not that they're weak. Maybe they're worn out.
Yes.
And they're too tired to, at that moment, take responsibility.
Yes.
But inside my mind, I want to punch them in the head and tell them to nut the fuck up and move on. Like,
you need to work some more on that empathy, my friend. Keep working on it.
we all have animal, we have primal instincts, you know?
Sure, like, sure.
I mean, everyone has the capacity and ability to kill someone in at least some type of circumstance.
Sure.
Like, it's not like we actually go and do it, but we all have these type of primal emotions.
Absolutely.
So,
I mean, yeah.
So, I mean, I don't go around punching people in the head for opening up about their past. I mean, that is strength in its own way, so long as it do it for the right purpose.
Well, yeah, absolutely. I agree with you. The primal urge to do things like that is there, but it is our logical mind that has to overcome that so that we don't get thrown in jail.
Exactly. I mean, if there wasn't a jail, then a lot of the people who talk about following the law, like, they would do horrible shit.
Yeah.
Just from that one change.
Yeah.
I mean, a lot of people, they say it's immoral to do something illegal because they just don't have the nuts to do it. I mean, because they risk being punished.
Yeah.
I mean, there are so many topics we can open up from. What the fuck was I about to say?
do I talk too much?
No, I enjoy it, man. That's why we both do it, you know?
Yeah, yeah. So, but that's an interesting topic. This whole thing about we are the product of our upbringing. And I'm a believer in that, but I'm also a believer in doing something about it. In other words, fixing the things that are wrong. You know, nobody was brought up perfect, and some people were brought up horribly. Either way, at some point in your adult life, you have to take it. It's like people who, for example, were raised, as they say, raised to be racist. You can be raised to hate black people, or if you're black, you can be raised to hate white people, whatever. But in your adult life, when you get information, it's your responsibility to process that information, which then leads you to a new way of thinking that racism is stupid. You know?
Yeah.
When does your own adult experience kick in and start guiding you? You know, how long can you blame your childhood for your problems?
Well, I think that depends, because of course there's what you were trying to get at, that we have responsibilities to expand our minds, and then there's the other part of environmental upbringing. Like where I live, when I went to school, like if I saw a black person, I fucking looked at them, maybe even stared at them. Uh-huh. Because I was not used to seeing that.
Yeah, but that's not racist.
No, it is not.
That's curiosity.
But then you add the fact that a lot of jails are packed with black people, and we have gypsies coming from nearby countries and stealing from us. They even steal people's wallets right in front of a security camera, just because they know if they get caught, they get a fucking hotel room in prison, and they get money.
Yeah. Yeah.
They get money to buy stuff for in prison, and they can send a bunch of that money to their families.
Yeah, there's no incentive for them to not commit those crimes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, seriously, like, if you kill someone, then it's a bit different. But if you do something like stealing or selling drugs, you'll go to, like, an open prison, which is essentially you have your own room. It's not a cell.
Yeah.
It's your own room. You have a bathroom, not just a toilet near your bed, like you see in movies. No, it's like a summer camp.
Yeah. It's
of course you're surrounded by immature idiots, and but it's like a summer camp.
Yeah. Wow.
So yeah, I mean, so imagine how people where I grew up, how they would be thinking, like every time someone said I have a friend from this country, like a lot of people, their first thought would be fucking immigrants, you know?
Yeah.
That kind of someone where they know not everyone is like that, and they know there's a possibility that they are being lied to in the social media, that most people probably aren't criminals, but they're just so tired of people coming and messing with us. Like, even like 8 years ago, it came up in the news that there were some people, immigrants, Islam people, who were protesting that we put up Christmas decorations on the street because they don't celebrate Christmas. And there were a bunch of people who wanted to vote that we never do that again. And that was just like, that's just fucked up. And I don't believe that most people would want to do that.
No.
I'm not trying to justify racism.
No.
I'm just saying that when you live in a place where you don't see a lot of people from different countries, you don't really get to experience what kind of culture they come from.
Right.
You hear all these stories and all these people do this type of bad things.
But how many
you are bound to have racism?
I have to contend with that a little bit, because I want to ask, how many of those stories are true? There's a lot of intentional spreading of lies. about immigrants. You know, there are people, of course, who are very much against immigration, and some of those people are very good at spreading falsehoods, false rumors.
You know,
it might be one, you know, person or one group who says, you know, we are Muslim and we don't want Christmas decorations that offend us. It might be one person, but these anti-immigration groups will spread that and make it sound like there's thousands of immigrants all over Norway or all over Denmark who are saying that.
Yeah, no, there aren't. And to be honest, we don't have that many ghettos in Denmark.
Yeah.
And it's not like the ghettos are filled with immigrants. They are also Danish criminals, a bunch of them, and banditos and hells angels and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But you have to go to a ghetto, and we don't have a lot of that, to find that kind of scene where black people are standing at a corner or outside an apartment building, and they might talk shit to you passing by, and if you talk back, they might stab you. But it's not all over the place, all over the country.
Yeah.
It's not like...
What is the total population? What is the total population in Denmark?
I don't know, 7-8 million people.
Okay.
So not that many.
What's the program you were going to mention?
A television program 5 years ago or something about homosexuality. They talked about homosexuals being beat up in the street for being homosexuals. And as an experiment, the host of the program, or like at least the man who was fronting for the camera, he said, okay, so these guys over there, they look like bad guys, and there is a lot of homosexuality going on around here. Let me hold your hand and walk down the street and see if they do anything. And one of them got so fucking angry, stood in front of them and told them not to do it. And because the man, who was not a homosexual, but suggested to do it, he said, no, don't be like that. He went to his fucking scooter, popped the seat, and pulled out a screwdriver and told him, stop holding his hand or I'll stab you with it.
Oh, wow.
And I have been stabbed by an immigrant also who was in a fucking wheelchair. I mean, I punched him out of his wheelchair. Because
in a wheelchair?
Me. He wanted to die, I think.
wanted to die.
I don't think that just because some people are from Islam, they think in such a bad way. I don't think that Islamists are homosexuals. I know a lot of them aren't. I talk to them.
Sure.
And I don't think just because I got stabbed by an immigrant in a wheelchair, I don't think that that handicapped people and people from other countries are bad people. I mean,
and that's good, because a lot of people do think that way. You know, they'll hear some anecdotal anecdotal evidence of this, that, and the other about a certain group of people, and they just blanket the entire group with that. And that's where we start running into problems. But you said something. You said you know that because you have spoken with them, and I believe that having that dialogue, having that exposure, having that contact with different aspects of, you know, whether it's religion or different cultures or whatever, having contact with them breaks down those barriers, and it shows that people are pretty much the same everywhere. Pretty much.
Yes, the law of repetition. The more you talk to them, the more you are. The better a view you have at them, towards them.
Exactly.
And if you are in a ghetto and you see some black people acting stupid, and you say, well, they are black, so black people must be like that, then you're the stupid one.
Yeah, you know, I try to take it on an individual basis. That guy is an idiot. Oh, he happens to be this, that, or the other beside it. But I try to take it on an individual. I don't try. I do take it on an individual basis. I get so irritated when I hear someone say, yeah, well, everyone has a little bit of racism in them. That is not true. I don't. I have zero. I don't know if that's a Danish thing, but you will hear that in Norway quite a bit. Everybody has a little bit of racism in them. Come on now. And
that sounds about as useful as when someone says that every female has a prostitute in them.
Well, I look at it as this: that person that says that everyone has racism in them, that person probably has racism in themselves, and they don't want to be lonely, so they try to justify that.
Yeah, that's my thought exactly. Yep. Fucking knee jerk reaction to justify the way you look at life and the
absolutely.
World.
Absolutely. So, listen, Matias, I do have to cut this short. I could talk to you forever, man. But
yeah, me too.
and I want to say this. We will talk again. I will absolutely invite you back if you if you would like to come on again.
Yeah, definitely. I have a lot of questions about your training that I want to ask you next time.
Yeah, you know, we actually had that as a topic that we were going to talk about. So I promise you, I will invite you back and we can talk all about that.
Sounds good.
Yeah, I love talking about my training.
Yeah, I just tend to want to talk about other shit because I've done training for so long, you know.
Yeah.
It's all the same to me a lot of times.
well, I like conversations like this because it's not one-dimensional, and I am an advocate for showing people that people who are active in the fitness world or the training world or if you're a powerlifter or whatever, you are also so much more than that. And I think you've shown that you have more aspects in your personality, more aspects in your daily life. You're more of a philosopher thinker, you know, as
thank you.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's pretty cool. That's cool stuff, I think.
Yeah. I mean, I used to be all about training, and I mean, it was a boring life, very boring. And my training suffered from it.
Yeah.
It absolutely did.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah.
Well, again, thank you so much for doing this episode. And you're more than welcome back. I consider you a friend. You are no longer someone I just know from Facebook. Now you're a friend. I call you brother now.
Okay, I call you friend too.
There we go. Okay, Matias, thank you so much. And we will talk again soon.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Okay.
Thanks for having me on.
My pleasure, my friend.
Take care.
Okay, bye.
Bye.
Okay, everybody, that was Matias Bergstrøm Andersen from Denmark. What a guy, what a guy, and what an episode. Thank you all so much for listening to this episode of the Coming Home Podcast with John Allen. Bye, everybody.
I'm coming home. Oh, I'm coming home. Yes, I am. Yes, I'm coming home. I'm coming home. Oh,